tonight.
The warhead on top of the Titan II was three times as powerful as all the bombs used in the Second World War.
Working on a weapon of mass destruction, you're counting on everything to work perfect all the time. And things just don't work perfect all the time.
Command and Control, on American Experience.
Fairly new to working out on the missile sites. At the age of 19, you know, you've got that no fear mentality. Right above us was a 9-megaton thermonuclear warhead. See the magnitude of that weapon within 10 feet from you? It was a monster waiting to go off. When you think about working on a weapon of mass destruction, you're counting on everything to work perfect all the time. And things just don't work perfect all the time.
The first thing that my commander heard, in other words,
the fuel vapors in the silo are just climbing and climbing and climbing.
We need to get the hell out of this complex, because this thing's going to blow up.
Do we let the world know? Do I run out and say, we got a potential nuclear explosion? What do you do?
That day, September 18th, it was basically 5 days before my 24th birthday. So I was 23. Lieutenant Childers was 24 as the deputy.
When we went on alert in a Titan system, we were on alert for 24 hours. That's what a tour was, 24 hours. We had 18 silos spread all the way out to the eastern corner of Arkansas. We went to a complex where there was supposed to be very little maintenance. That was 4-7.
We went up the main highway to a certain point, and then you had to pull off the highway onto much smaller roads. Until you came over a particular rise, you wouldn't even know that the missile complex was there.
As we drove up to Missile Complex 4-7, it's very unassuming.
There's not a lot there. There's this huge door, and there's some antennas. However, underneath that door was the most powerful warhead that the U.S. has ever operated.
Before you left the base, they gave you some codes that gave you access to the complex. You would read the code to the commander, and then you would take a lighter, set the codes on fire, and drop them down into a box that they would burn up, and no one else could use those codes.
All four of the crew members went down three flights of stairs. At the bottom of that, you got to a blast door. There were a series of blast doors, 6, 7, 8, and 9.
So you'd walk through this and you'd step into the middle level of the launch control center with all of the equipment that you needed to maintain the missile.
When we took charge of a complex, that meant that we owned that missile until the next crew came out. So if we went to war, we were prepared to launch those weapons on command.
Apps power, silo soft, guidance go, we're standing by for fire engine.
We never knew what our specific targets were because you didn't really want to know who you were going to destroy.
Turning on my command of ready to turn keys, on the word keys we will turn. Is the crew ready? The BMAT?
BMAT ready.
MFT?
MFT ready.
Deputy?
Deputy
ready. Crew is ready. Ready?
You had to be prepared to destroy an entire civilization. And we were trained on that. I still today refer to myself and other missileers as crew dogs. You had to almost be rote in your actions and not question the fact that you were going to destroy an entire civilization if you had to launch those ICBMs. As heartless as it sounds, I never had a problem with it. I was doing it for my country. I was doing it to protect my country. The whole reason I sat out there was to prevent that kind of thing from happening. That's what deterrence was about. But deterrence is worthless if you don't demonstrate that you're willing to do it, too. And we always had to demonstrate that I would walk out there and turn those keys in a second, and I would kill 10 million people and never hesitate. Every time I went onto a complex, every time I saw the Titan II missile, I had the same sense of excitement.
You couldn't see the warhead from the bottom because you were 8 stories down, and the cone of the warhead disappeared off in the distance.
The warhead on top of the Titan II was 3 times as powerful as all the bombs used by all of the armies in the Second World War, including both the atomic bombs. When the crew members successfully turned the keys, that 330,000-pound missile would lift up out of the silo.
And it would head out for about 5 minutes of powered flight to the edge of space. Fly for another 20 minutes and hit its target halfway around the world.
Before September 18th, the only warheads that we thought would go off in the United States would be Soviet warheads. We never considered that our own warheads could detonate on our own continent.
From the very beginning of the atomic age, there has been a sense of this immense power just being on the verge of slipping out of our control. The world's first nuclear device was fully assembled in a small tent in the middle of the desert. Nobody was sure what would happen when this thing would detonate. They were even concerned that when the first nuclear device detonated, the Earth's atmosphere would catch on fire and every single living thing on Earth would die. And yet they did the test anyway. After the war ended, an engineering section of the nuclear weapons program became known as the Sandia Laboratory. And Sandia became America's first atomic bomb factory.
I realized if I joined Sandia, I would be working on atomic bombs. And that was okay with me. We were driven by the fear of the Soviet Union.
You couldn't talk about what you did outside of the tech area, but you could feel a sense of this is the number one national priority.
The early atomic bombs were essentially handmade. And if you wanted to use one, it would take days for a team of 20 or 30 people to put it together.
My computer was a slide rule. You ever seen a slide rule, anybody?
We pressed and pressed to improve the early product, to make it smaller and more deadly. Anything we conceived of, the military wanted, and money was free.
As the technology improved, as the number of nuclear weapons in our arsenal increased, there were soon assembly lines for making nuclear weapons. We had bombers in the air at all times, loaded with nuclear weapons. We had submarines that had missiles carrying nuclear warheads. It was feared that the Soviets would have far more missiles than the United States, so we went on a huge missile building binge. At one point, we only thought we needed 50 to 200 nuclear weapons to completely annihilate the Soviet Union. And by the mid-1960s, we had 32,000 nuclear weapons. But every one of those weapons you build not only threatens your enemy, but poses a threat to yourself.
September 18th was one of those days where nothing was going the way it was supposed to go.
Step one, power on-off switch, on.
What we did every day is we went through a daily shift verification checklist. We had a whole book full of checklists, and we lived by checklists.
On-off rotary switch, on.
That day, September 18th, we find out that we're going to actually have some major maintenance because they have a problem with the oxidizer tank that pressure is a little bit low.
Each stage of the missile had two separate tanks. One was filled with fuel and the other was filled with oxidizer.
All you got to do is mix those two fuels and you're going to have an explosion. We called back to base. They said we had a maintenance team coming out, a specialized unit. They called them the PTS team.
The difference between PTS people and any other person on a missile site is we get to play with fuel and oxidizer, and they don't. I loved PTS. I loved my job. My major goal at that time was to be a PTS team chief and be the best PTS team chief ever.
When I arrived at Little Rock Air Force Base,
I would have been 19, yeah. Oh, no, 18. My birthday is in March, so I would have been 1 month away from being 19. I think I was ready to take on the world at that point. I wanted to go out to the field and work on that Titan II missile. You know, we called it a bird, and I wanted to work on the birds, you know.
Rocket fuel is extremely poisonous. We were always told if we could smell it, it was already too much.
Oxidizer, when you breathe it, it turns to nitric acid. And you basically drown in your lungs if you breathe enough of it.
We would work 12, 14 hour, up to 16 hour shifts. And then go to sleep, and then 5 hours later or so, you get up and head back in for another 12, 13 or 14 hour day.
September 18th, we'd had a long week. We had the next day off. So when we finished the maintenance task at the site that we were at, you know, we thought we were done. Our team chief called back to the base to tell them we were on our way back. And they said, well, before you come back, we want you to stop over at 4-7 at Damascus. When we got there, they didn't have the right part. They had to bring the part out on a helicopter. I would say we waited from 3:30 to about 6 in the evening before we could actually enter the silo. We'd been on duty about 11 and a half hours. Myself and Airman Plum suited up into a Revco.
You're wearing this backpack for air. Then you're going to slip into a stiff neoprene rubber glove that your hand just floats around inside of. It's not tight.
The only way of communication we had was these radios. And they didn't always work correctly. You could very easily misunderstand.
Right, flash that hose on, 233 liquid line.
So we started down the cableway to the silo when all of a sudden I realized that I had forgotten the torque wrench up in the truck. There was a change in the checklist that we were supposed to use a torque wrench from here on out, but that was a recent change. I had spent 3 years basically taking the pressure cap off with the ratchet. And so instead of sending somebody back to get the torque wrench, I grabbed the ratchet to do that. The ratchet's about 3 feet long and the socket's about 8 pounds. And I radioed to the team chief that we're ready to begin the checklist for pressurization of stage 2 oxidizer tank.
We had a problem with that ratchet. I wouldn't allow Dave to actually get the socket to clip or snap into place to be secure. He held the socket up against the dust cap and he put the ratchet up against it.
Basically, you hold it with one hand on that ratchet handle and one hand cradles the head of the ratchet with the socket on it.
And so I got on the end of it and kind of gave it a little force. And I remember saying to him, you got this? Yeah, I got it. Let go of it.
And I go to pick it up and the socket falls off the end of the ratchet.
Just boom, right through the hole and just straight down. As it was falling, I was thinking, oh no, oh no, oh no. I wanted to jump after that thing.
Anytime I want, I can close my eyes and see that socket. I see the socket bouncing off the platform. I see my Revco glove reaching for it. And I see it falling in slow motion. 70 feet. Hitting the thrust mount like it had eyeballs. And then a stream of fuel coming out of the missile.
I was just in total shock. I think we both just looked at each other for a second and we're like, oh my God, what are we gonna do? That missile was just blowing fuel. Then the magnitude set in as far as what could happen. The destructive force, that thing exploded and we can't stop it.
Nineteen years before the Damascus accident, a B-52 bomber carrying two powerful hydrogen bombs took off on a routine mission over North Carolina. During the mission, the plane experienced a fuel leak, and suddenly the B-52 began to break apart midair. As the fuselage was spinning and heading back towards Earth, the centrifugal forces pulled on a lanyard in the cockpit. And that lanyard was pulled exactly the way it would be if a crew member wanted to release its hydrogen bombs over enemy territory.
Bombs are relatively dumb. They sort of think that if you drop the bomb out of the bomb bay, you must have intended to do that.
One of the weapons in particular went through all of its arming steps to detonate. And when that weapon hit the ground, a firing signal was sent. And the only thing that prevented a full-scale detonation of a powerful hydrogen bomb in North Carolina was a single safety switch.
All it is a two-position on-off switch. That prevented a 4-megaton disaster. If the right two wires had touched, the bomb would have detonated, period.
The Goldsboro accident occurred at a time when the number of nuclear weapons accidents was increasing.
I read through all of the known accident reports. Scared the hell out of me.
Three bombs that fell on land weren't all recovered till 5 days after the crash.
We were shocked when we realized all these years we've been thinking along this nice, neat line. That's not reality. These orderly sequence of events were not going to happen in an accident, because an accident, by definition, is something not definable.
There had been all these statistical assurances that weapons wouldn't detonate in an accident. And then there was a realization that the weapons were nowhere near as safe as everyone had assumed.
We knew that fire, for example, could set off these electro-explosive devices inside the warhead in a random way.
During a fire, the solder might melt on a circuit board. It created all kinds of new electrical pathways that could completely circumvent a safety device.
of the 20 or 25,000 weapons that we had in stockpile. I could not, in good conscience, swear that they were adequately safe.
You had Bob Purifoy, one of the vice presidents of the lab, and Bill Stevens, the head of the safety department at Sandia, saying thousands of weapons in the American nuclear arsenal were vulnerable during an accident, including the most powerful warhead on an American missile, the warhead on top of the Titan II.
I was sitting down in the kitchen eating a sandwich when the klaxon went off. So I didn't think too much of it. I mean, it went off. It's like, okay, they're doing their procedures. But about 10 seconds later, we got another klaxon. I got up and I walked about halfway down the stairs and I looked down and I could see the commander's console, and the commander's console has lots of red lights flashing. And so I know something's wrong.
Captain Mazzaro was the crew commander. The first thing that Mazzaro heard and that the other team members heard are the words, uh-oh. Mazzaro said, what do you mean, uh-oh, what's going on? They said there's smoke in the bottom of the launch duct. Commander is trying to clear up, what do you mean smoke in the bottom of the launch duct? Do you see a fire?
The fuel vapors in a silo are just climbing and climbing and climbing. So I radioed back that we had a cloud, a milky white cloud. I wasn't going to say fuel over the radio. The reason I didn't want to say the word fuel over the radio was because in case the missile commander was listening, I didn't want him to freak out.
I think David was just scared to say anything about really what was happening. Only being 21 years old, I guess it'd almost be like, you know, you're doing something wrong as a kid and you gotta tell your parents about it, you know? You know how you're gonna just stand there and you don't wanna say what you just did?
I grabbed Plum and we walked back up the cableway. I immediately started looking at the fuel level reader. When it hits that explosive level, any spark can set off the fuel.
You could run through each of the tanks on each stage and see what the pressure was. And we saw that the pressure was dropping. It was dropping fast. And then all of a sudden, sprays came on in a launch duct. We thought, well, there must be a fire. It doesn't make any sense. Nothing made any sense. And I jumped into my checklist. We did everything according to checklist. You know, we ran the oxidizer checklist. We ran the fuel checklist. You know, you stay in the checklist, it'll take care of you.
About that time, the PTS team had been out working, had gotten back. And they're standing over in the short cableway, and the maintenance team chief went over and met him, and they started talking. At that point, I said, okay, guys, what happened? And they came in, and then they explained to the crew at that point exactly what happened.
And that's when we finally got him to admit that he had done something, that he had dropped it, and there was a hole. And he saw vapors coming out. It was more than uh-oh. And that was the first time we knew. It was a good half hour into it. By then, it was basically out of control.
When I became Secretary of Defense, we had tens of thousands of nuclear weapons. the numbers were a big problem because it only takes a few or one getting out of hand to cause a catastrophic problem. And we worried about that. We probably didn't worry about it enough. The Titan II missiles by 1980 were both old and much more prone to accidents.
At a silo near Searcy, 53 construction workers died when a welding torch sparked flammable hydraulic oil.
Nitrogen tetroxide drifted from the missile site.
This would be missile leak number 10 so far in Arkansas.
Why was it still in the arsenal? In part because it was the only missile that had a heavy payload.
The United States had 1,000 land-based missiles, and those 54 Titan IIs represented one-third of the megatonnage of our entire missile force. In September 1980, the Soviet Union was in the midst of a huge nuclear arms buildup. By then, they had more land-based missiles than we did.
It also, I think, was part of a negotiating strategy. We anticipated trading them off against Soviet heavy missiles in strategic arms negotiations.
It was a bargaining chip, something that we could give up in order to persuade the Soviets to get rid of a class of their missiles.
So that was why we still had it, and it was therefore available for an accident.
Of the 18 Titan missiles stationed in Kansas, there were serious leaks in 17.
Nearly 14,000 gallons of poisonous liquid fuel poured out, killing two persons and injuring more than 20 others.
The Titan II's potentially an awesome weapon of war, whose only victims so far have been Americans.
There are stories about accidents that might have happened in Kansas or maybe one or two smaller ones in Arkansas. I think more and more it became a matter of concern.
A year before the Damascus accident, Senator David Pryor and I toured a Titan missile site. We were concerned about safety issues. They were very helpful. They answered questions. And we had a very pleasant educational tour of a Titan missile site. We talked about how helpful it was. And quite frankly, had some reassurance that maybe things were okay, that maybe things weren't as bad as we had been led to believe.
I was very, very impressed with it. Was, of course, the Titan II. It's about 110 feet tall.
We get back, and in a matter of no time, a phone call comes from some airmen who said they'd like to meet with us. They wanted to come to our office. They didn't want anybody to know that we were meeting.
We met there that night, scared to death. You know, we were 20-something kids. We had no idea what we were doing.
We took the logbook to their office and showed them. They put your life in danger, and they didn't tell you that when they sent you out there.
The day that they had walked the senator through the site, their hazard sensing system was off alert. If the system is down, you could have vapors in the silo that could kill you. And so they should have provided the senator with a gas mask. But they just walked him through like it was a normal day and there was no problem. The Air Force didn't want the senator to have any understanding of just how unreliable the systems were. People inside of our chain of command weren't listening to us, and that's why we went to Senator Pryor. And we told him about our absolute fear for the safety of Arkansas, the safety of everybody working on those systems.
They were telling me that it wasn't a matter of if we were going to have an explosion, it was a matter of when. After that meeting, we proposed a warning siren at each of the silos, much like a tornado warning sign.
On Tuesday, I passed an amendment going to mandate the Air Force to put early warning systems on all of the 54 missile sites in this country.
The passage of that amendment was on September 17th, 2 days before the tragedy at Damascus.
September 18th, 1980, I got a call from the command post that we had a serious problem. In June of 1980, I had assumed command of the 308th Strategic Missile Wing at Little Rock Air Force Base, and that was a Titan wing. I had no previous experience in Titan. I had no training in Titan, so I was a new guy. I had about 3 months under my belt before the accident occurred on the night of September 18th. I got to the command center, started to figure out what was going on. Nobody knew too much about what happened except that a socket dropped in a silo. I had heard before that tools have been dropped, but they always went straight to the bottom. But in this case, it penetrated the missile. I had no idea that that could ever happen. I had never even given that a thought at all. And then I activated the Missile Potential Hazard Team.
The Missile Potential Hazard Team gathered together some of the top figures in the Air Force to deal with the accident. At Barksdale Air Force Base in Louisiana, there was Colonel Ben Scaller, the Air Force's leading expert on the Titan II missile.
As we're dumping fuel, things are heating up in that silo in the launch deck all the time. If the temperature rises, the oxidizer expands, and there's a possibility that it can rupture a tank. And with a silo full of fuel, you rupture an oxidizer tank, and the oxidizer hits the fuel, it's gone.
In Denver, there were executives from Martin Marietta who designed and built the Titan II missile.
And in Omaha, Nebraska, there was the underground headquarters of the Strategic Air Command, known as SAC. That night, all the major decisions would be made at SAC headquarters.
The Strategic Air Command handled the nuclear weapons for the Air Force. SAC was a very, very professional organization, and there were no errors really tolerated.
The night of the accident, General Lloyd Levitt assumed control of the Missile Potential Hazard Team.
General Levitt was a very dedicated pilot, a very courageous pilot in Korea and Vietnam, but he had no missile background at all that I'm aware of. As things progressed, we were trying to do everything we could. We knew what was going to happen if we lost pressure in a fuel tank. Of course, the missile was going to collapse on top of itself. The pressures in the tanks kept the missile erect. If we lost all the pressure in that, the missile would collapse upon itself. If the missile collapsed, the entire missile would blow up. But what would happen to the warhead was anybody's guess. There was no one that we kept on alert that knew anything about the warhead. There was no checklist. Probably the only thing that I ever was involved with was Strategic Air Command that there wasn't a checklist for. And so it became a seat of the pants operation as things unfolded, and I used every resource we had that night to try to face the problem and solve the problem. One of the options was, if the silo closure door was open, there's a possibility that the gas could have been vented. But there was also a possibility, if the missile did explode while that door was open, it would throw the warhead out of the silo. We would not have known where it went. It could go almost anywhere.
Very few people, almost none in a decision-making capacity, have ever seen a nuclear explosion. I went out to the Pacific in 1954. I would have been 26, having worked for a couple of years before that.
on the development of nuclear weapons.
In 1954, the United States was testing a new design for a hydrogen bomb. It was the same sort of weapon that would later be put on top of the Titan II. It had been anticipated that the blast would be about 5 megatons. That is the equivalent of 5 million tons of TNT. When the device detonated, there was an enormous explosion that got bigger and bigger and bigger. And soon, the observers were terrified because they didn't know when it was going to stop. The Bravo test wound up being 3 times more powerful than they had estimated.
I saw it go off from a distance of 200 miles. All you see is the light. The light stays on for a long time. And if you see it from total darkness, it gets bright enough to read a newspaper by that light. That's enormously impressive. Everybody knew that there was a great deal of radioactivity generated in a nuclear explosion. The question always was, what would happen to it?
Radiation survey teams were flown back to the exposed atoll.
We were able to document for the first time fallout data from high-yield detonations. Fallout blanketed areas of more than 5,000 square miles with radioactive material that would have been lethal to unprotected personnel.
Back in Washington, they took a map of the fallout pattern from the Bravo test and they superimposed it on a map of the United States. A similar weapon detonated over Washington, D.C., could release enough radioactive fallout to kill everyone in Washington, D.C., everyone in Baltimore, everyone in Philadelphia, half the population of New York City, with casualties and fatalities as far north as Boston.
The fuel tank reading started going negative. And at that point, I felt that it was potentially going to collapse. And although there are safety measures within the warhead, in the back of my mind, you always wonder. I don't think anybody truly knew what was going to happen with the warhead.
As they were talking about these tank pressures and all these different things, I'm getting more and more anxious thinking, we need to get out of here. We need to get the hell out of this complex because this thing's going to blow up.
At this point, Mazzara wanted to evacuate the control center. He didn't really want to be down there if it did explode.
Some of the crew members were eager to make an exit, so with that in mind, we started discussing, should we evacuate the people in the launch control center or leave them in there? The reason to get them out of the silo, we had no idea what was going to happen to the launch control center if the missile exploded.
I still thought we should be there. We needed to be there.
If we evacuated that launch control center, we would be giving up any ability to control any of the equipment. We would be giving up the capacity to try any of the ideas that people were trying to come up with in order to save this system.
Rodney and I told the crew commander that we wanted to stay behind. I couldn't leave. You know, emotionally, I couldn't go.
From our standpoint, we could stay because neither one of us had children at that time, and Not that we didn't care about our lives, but, you know, it just seemed that it made sense to us that we should stay and let everybody else go.
On the evening of September 18th, people were gathering in Hot Springs. Vice President Mondale was the keynote speaker. Senator Pryor and Governor Clinton and others had already gone to Hot Springs. And I was scheduled to go over the next day. That night, we had invited a friend over for dinner, and the phone rang. And it was one of the airmen whom I had talked with. But when I got off the phone from this airman, I looked around and people started asking me, saying, what's happening? And I said, a Titan missile is going to explode. And the question was, well, what does that mean? What it means is if that nuclear warhead explodes, we're incinerated. I said, Little Rock's gone. I said, Little Rock is gone. We're 46 miles from this site. We're gone. I walked into our living room and looked out the front window. And it was still daylight savings time. So it wasn't totally dark, and you could see children in the front yard, people walking out to their cars, carrying on their normal everyday lives. And I thought, do I run out on the street and say, we got a potential nuclear explosion 46 miles from here? Do I grab my friends and neighbors and get in the car and start driving? Do I call Senator Pryor and say, let's call a press conference and tell them that the Air Force is not telling the truth? What do you do?
I was there in the Hot Springs at night, and the phone rang, and it was Skip. And Skip says, we have a problem.
He said, what's the Air Force saying? I said, the Air Force is telling people it's not happening. That's what they've told the people on the site. They're going to tell you that these things are under control. But I think you need to be prepared for an explosion.
As the general manager of the radio station in Clinton, we were doing quite a bit of local news, and you realize in a small town that you need to have a police scanner because everything comes off of it. And the person said, we've got a chemical leak at the Titan II missile silo. We get there about the same time the sheriff is getting there, Gus Anglin. This is Gus Anglin. He was the sheriff of Van Buren County, very popular sheriff, by the way. And so we decided to walk down the narrow road that goes down to the silo. And when you get down there, there's like this 10-foot tall chain link fencing with barbed wire on the top of it. Out of nowhere, here comes two guys with M16 rifles. Gus says, do I need to start evacuating? Oh, no, sir. We've got it under control, I assure you. You know, if they'd come up and said, man, we got a hell of a situation, this thing may blow like hell, I'd have got out of there.
You know, the attitude that a lot of military commanders have was to tell everybody, everything's okay, we'll take care of it. And that's what we were doing that night. That was the wrong answer.
So we went back to the edge of the road, which is just off Highway 65. There's homes real close to the silo.
My mother said, there's something wrong at the missile base. There's a lot of cars going in. The missile site is probably less than a quarter of a mile through the field from the back door. They basically condemned our land and took it. We didn't know the danger. We didn't know that was a nuclear missile there.
I mean, it was a secret base. It had a chain link fence with barbed wire around the top, guards. Big signs on the fence said, we're gonna shoot you if you come in here. You wasn't going to change it, and we wasn't going to move. It just didn't make much sense to dwell on it, so you just put up with it. You know, like bad neighbor in-law or something, you know? But the crowds are starting to gather on 65.
This is as close as the military will allow us to get.
So here comes Channel 4, here comes Channel 11. Before you know it, we've got about 25 people out there. They ignored us. We'd yell at them as they come by. You go, hey, is everything under control? You know, have you fixed it yet? And they'd just keep driving. They wouldn't even acknowledge that you existed.
My dad talked to a man that was in law enforcement that he knew. This law enforcement man said, Ralph, get your family and get out of here. And if you tell this, I'll get fired. And we all got together and drove to Choctaw to spend the night.
Sheriff Gus Angler, he didn't get the information he thought he needed from him to make really good decisions. And finally, he just went to running everybody off when they were evacuating. He said, you know, I don't know how bad it's going to be. If I can help, get out of here right now, and then we'll get you back in quick as we can. They had roadblocks set up like 2 miles from it, diverting traffic around the area. I had a problem that 9 months before that happened, I had synchronized a bunch of heifers, which means you give them a shot of luteolice, they all come in heat at the same time. You breed them all at the same time, which also means they're all going to calve at the same time. Well, they were due date was that day. We would have lost the farm, everything we had, you know, if them cows got sick and died. So I mean, we were going back in.
We finally made the decision to evacuate the crew because when a missile explodes, if it does explode, you're risking life of the 4 crew members on site. So we thought the best avenue was to take the crew out of the control center.
Mike said, we're gonna have to evacuate. It was one of the hardest things I think anybody could do because you were responsible for a nuclear weapon that was capable of destroying an unbelievable amount of territory and an unbelievable number of people. And you were leaving it behind. And you owned it, you know, for that alert, you owned it and you had to give it up. And there was nobody to give it to. Nobody left it before. Nobody would leave a nuclear warhead. The whole time I was leaving, I kept thinking, I need to stay, I should have stayed. I look back on it now, I still can't believe we left it empty. I had all these classified checklists. Nobody had ever tried to put them in a safe before. They wouldn't fit. So we left all of them in the safe with the door open.
Fuel vapor can ignite. And so we need to cut as much electrical power from the silo as we can. We don't want any electrical spark or anything going on.
We thought, we're gonna go out the regular way. We'll open the door up.
As we started to open the blast door, we immediately saw vapor. Once we closed that door, that cut off our main escape route. We were instructed to evacuate through the emergency escape hatch, which we had never actually fully opened.
It's just a metal tube with a ladder in it, buried a good 40 feet under the ground. There's a light at the top, and it's supposed to shine down into the escape route. And it didn't come on. It wasn't working. Nothing was working.
We had donned gas masks because there was some concern about missile fuel vapors blowing over the escape hatch.
It was a hell of a thing to climb up 5 stories in the dark with this mask on, and you couldn't breathe, and it filled up with vapors, and you couldn't see anything. We knew there was very little wind that night, and all of the vapors that were being evacuated out of the launch duct was settling over the site.
I was at home with my wife and kid, and I got a call from job control, and they said they had a problem out at 47. So I drove up to the barracks, and I was banging on doors getting PTS guys.
They told everybody here, this is a very dangerous situation. We don't know what's going to happen. This is a purely voluntary mission only. And if you don't want to go, you don't have to go. The PTS group, there's like a brotherhood. There's no question that we weren't going to be the team that was going out there. Dave Livingston was one of the guys, and he was sitting in the back seat. And he said to me, somebody's going to die out here tonight. I just feel it. And I said, Dave, don't say something like that, man. Don't even say it. And he goes, no, I got a bad vibe, man. Somebody's going to die out here, man.
We know at this point that there's a helicopter on the way, and Jeff Kennedy was on there. He was one of the best, if not the best, team chief in the wing.
Jeff Kennedy was the kind of guy that he would never ask you to do anything he wouldn't do himself.
He had an authoritative voice that would just, you know, kind of rattle your cage.
When I got on site, Powell come running up to me and said, Jeff, I f***ed up like you wouldn't believe. I know that I need to get the tank readings to find out how serious the leak is.
Getting the tank pressure readings was probably the most important thing that we could do. Jeff thought, the longer we wait, the more dangerous it gets. What Jeff didn't tell anybody was, we're going to go down into that silo and look at those pressures. So we run across the silo to the escape hatch. Kennedy goes into the tube first, I follow him in, and all of a sudden he looks up at me and he says, stay here. We violated the most sacred rule in SAC, which is the two-man rule. Nobody goes to certain parts of the silo without being accompanied by another person. He felt like that he could get in and out quicker if he went by himself.
The stage one fuel was now in a negative balance. This 14,000 gallons of fuel that have leaked out of the tank. It sends off a tremendous amount of heat. Oxidizer reacts to heat. So now we have less than 30 pounds of pressure before stage one oxidizer blows.
Kennedy shows the readings that he just got and says, we still had time to save it, but we had to move. We had to move now.
The commander was furious that he had violated the two-man policy by going down there and didn't even have a crew member with him. Just on his own, he violated everything.
The colonel now calls SAC headquarters. 15 minutes later, SAC headquarters relieves us of all command decision-making. Now, here's SAC headquarters that has never stepped foot on a complex. They're making decisions on what's going to happen. That just pissed me off.
Time was of the essence if we were going to accomplish anything. Every minute that passed by, we were further, simply because we're dumping more fuel and everything is getting worse.
We all thought it was getting to be more and more dangerous to go into site. Martin Marietta, the manufacturer of the missile, told us to back out and just wait and see. Martin Marietta recommended not to even go in or go near the missile, and if it blew, there would be no injuries. SAC made the decision to, not listen to Martin Marietta.
People started showing up from base. Communications, portable vapor detectors. They were bringing all kinds of maintenance equipment.
You think all of these experts must be coming in to work on this thing. Then I see this bus come in. And here are these about 10 guys. And they start putting on what looks like space outfits. And you're looking at these and you're thinking, I'm 24 years old and they're all younger than me. And these guys are the experts that are gonna go in there and fix this. All I saw was just young guys that were being thrown to the lions.
One of the hard things for us was, it seemed like we were waiting and waiting and waiting for some decision to be made at SAC as specifically what to do. So the time frame of like, man, you know, whatever we're gonna do, let's do it.
The SAC command center finally decided that we had to know what the status was in the silo if we could get back in. Well, they considered the best alternative was go back in and check pressures.
When we find out what the plan is, we have to break into a nuclear missile complex, which has never been done before in history.
If we had stayed in the control center, we could have opened every door they had to break their way in.
The plan was to go down and go through the blast doors, get into the control center. And depending on the fuel and oxidizer readings, they wanted to get to the missile itself. The real grand scheme was to go out to the silo to level 4, open up a valve to vent that tank so it would stabilize and not collapse.
And the only way we could try to save the thing was to get into it and connect up to the missile and have an emergency offload.
That was absolute total bullshit. You know, I said, Colonel, why don't we just go down the escape hatch? Candy, this plan has come down. This is the plan we're going to go with, and that's it.
Jeff thought the plan was nuts, but on the other hand, this is what you do. You're a PTS guy. This is the plan that came down, and you suck it up and you do it.
We were directed to ask for volunteers to go back in. I personally wasn't in favor of sending anybody else in after all the time. It was wee hours of the morning. This has been going on for many hours at this point, probably 8 hours. But I guess you go back and say, as a good soldier, your boss says, do this, and you eventually do it. And we had enough brave souls to volunteer to go back in the silo.
Rex, Huckel, and I were the first guys to go in. They said, you only have 30 minutes of air. There is no crew down there. The crew is already evacuated. So they said, you're going to have to cut and break your way into this missile complex.
And they got the exhaust duct, took a reading, and the meter pegged out, which was 250 parts per million. I had made a recommendation that, and if it was 250 parts per million or higher, we backed off because the protective clothing wouldn't protect our guys.
250 parts per million is when the vapor is in such a high concentration, it could start to melt the REFCO suits. Almost anything could cause it to ignite.
General Levitt directed them to press on. I knew it was the wrong thing to do. Whatever was going to happen was not going to be good.
We got to the portal door. We used bolt cutters and a great big crowbar to pry open the main lock. And then go down 3 levels of steps to get to your first 6,000-pound blast lock door with great big hydraulic pins that lock it in place. We had to manually start to pump it open. We'd never used that hydraulic pump. We were getting close to the 30 minutes of air, and then they sent us back. So they said, you guys got it hooked up. Come on back. We're going to send Kennedy and Livingston in to replace you.
Those guys were brave. They knew what they were getting into when they went back in on the underground, what could happen to them.
I was sitting in a security police vehicle listening and hearing what's going on. The next team went in, which was going to be Kennedy and Livingston. They're relaying the information that they've opened the blast door.
When we went into the blast block area, there's eight lights, bright as hell. I'm less than 10 feet away from it, and I can't even see it.
So they immediately evacuated and started topside.
I get topside, and now we get a command from the team chief to go down and turn on an exhaust fan. Livingston taps himself on the chest, and he went down.
After that, within seconds, I saw the explosion.
PTS 1, do you copy?
All of a sudden, I lost all communications.
PTS 1, do you copy? I repeat, PTS 1, do you copy?
Everything you ever read or heard about a nuclear explosion, all communications were lost until things settled out. And that's the first thing that's the first thing that entered my mind, that we had a nuclear explosion out there. And we may have a shockwave coming into Little Rock Air Force Base and all the surrounding communities. And that's the first thing I thought about. And all people would be dead out there on site, of course. And I just, it was unimaginable what was going through my mind. It was almost like you wanted to get down on your knees and pray to the higher power to protect everybody. It was a very traumatic moment in my life. It affects me to this day when I think about that.
About 3 o'clock in the morning, I decided, well, might as well go milk. And just before I got to the roadblock, you drop off a hill on Highway 65, there's a spot that you can see the ground at the missile base. And just as I got to that spot, it blew. Felt it more than you saw it. I mean, I was a mile and three quarters, 2 miles away from it, and it almost shook my truck off the road.
The explosion woke us up 8 miles away in Choctaw. It shook the home, it shook the bed you were in, and we immediately all jumped up. And my dad said, get everybody, get in the cars, and we're heading north.
Gus was sitting in his sheriff's car. I was sitting on the hood of Gus's car. Just kind of sitting there, and had on slip-on shoes and was kicking one off and on. Then all of a sudden, it was just cold. So everybody was running as hard as they could to get out of there because we may be living our last few minutes.
Go, go, go.
I thought when I jumped in my car and drove as hard as I could, that I was probably outrunning a nuclear blast. You know, I thought, this Dodge Omni is going to outrun this thing, you know. And I remember we had almost made it to Choctaw, and I turned to Tom and I said, we just left a bunch of dead people back there, Tom.
The sky just lit up. It really looked like the sun was coming up, which is why our initial reaction was, the nuclear bomb went off. The nuclear warhead exploded.
I look up and I saw fire shooting straight up out of the silo, 1,000 feet, maybe more. And it's like a Roman candle just shooting straight up in the air.
We ducked under the tailgate of a truck.
so much gravel and rocks were coming down. It was smashing windshields and putting holes in trucks. And I was literally trying to crawl underneath the truck. And it started to move, and I crawled out again real fast, and somebody drove it off.
Oh, my God.
The stuff stopped falling, but there was flames everywhere, and you could hear this roar. And you look down there, you can see the steam and fire coming out of the complex.
All I know is the first thing that hit me was wind. It was like a boom, just like a concussion, man. It was like bang, and you're blown backwards. You have no control over anything. As I'm sliding on my back, burning, going up the street, my left eye opened, and I could see glowing steel blowing past me. And in my heart, I said, it's over. You're not going to live through this. You know, I just hope it's not painful. That's the only thing that went through my brain. I hope it's not painful. And I heard two blood-curdling screams to run, run. I got up and took off running. I got 5 steps away, and a chunk of concrete bigger than a school bus hits the ground right behind me. And it's got steel rebar hanging out of it. As I'm running, I feel this whack hit my ankle and just shatters my ankle. The next step I took, I just buckled and went down. That's when I started to realize that my face and neck and back were all on fire.
And I was picking people up and carrying them up the road, trying to get them away from the debris. I remember helping one of them into the back of a truck. And as we were carrying him, the suit would snag on rocks and rebar and just wrench his broken leg. And he was just screaming in pain.
And they said, Devlin, you got to go to the hospital. And I said, no, don't take me until you have Livingston, until you have Kennedy. I don't want to leave until you have everybody. And he said, no, man, we got it. We're going to send you now. We got to get you to the hospital.
All you heard was evacuate, evacuate, evacuate. Air Force Colonel said, the other two are on the site. They have to be dead. And we looked down at the site and said, I'm with you, Colonel. They have to be dead. I got into the last truck that was there with a bunch of hurt guys. And I said, let's go.
As soon as it blew, I can remember being flipped ass over tea kettle. When I woke up, I was laying on my back and my legs were up against the complex fence. I was screaming and crying. There was nobody there. Absolutely zero. You only had yourself. You know, the pain I had to deal with was trivial to the fact that I wanted to live. I wanted to survive. I mean, I saw my kids, my wife. I said, I am not going to die in this conflict. I went to stand up, and I fell right down. My leg was broken. Oh, I fell down 4 or 5 times, got back up. All the time that I'm walking, I can hear Livingston. Oh my God, help me. Please, somebody help me. Because of my leg being broken, I determined that I could not get him. This is something that I fought with for eons. If Livingston had known that I was there, would that have been enough of an adrenaline rush to know somebody's gonna get some help? Off the complex with a truck, I had to make it from one end of the complex to the other. You know, I fell down half a dozen times. It had to take me 45 minutes. When I got to the truck and I radioed for help, the truck went dead.
Come on.
way back to the missile site, I could hear Kennedy on her radio in the truck.
Help! Help me! Help me! Can anybody read me?
And I headed down the road as fast as I could get that truck to go. I got partway there, and two security policemen were in the road, and they waved me down. And he told us to evacuate and not go down there. And I said, screw you, our friends are down there, we're going. I got back to the missile site. I saw Kennedy. He was burnt. And he had a hole in his leg the size of your fist. He was really hurt bad. And he told me to go find Livingston. We put our helmets on and we went onto the site. It was like another world. Ordnance guys had told us that the warhead was full of plastic explosives that could be laying all over the ground, so somehow we were not supposed to step on them. There was giant chunks of concrete blasted all over. It looked like the size of semi-trucks. There's a strange glow coming out of where the silo used to be. And when we got back to the truck, they had already found Livingston. And I was angry because they didn't have an ambulance. Put him in the back of a pickup truck. And I held him. He begged me not to tell his mother. Like he had done something wrong. And I told him that he didn't do anything wrong.
When we arrived at the hospital, I was hyperventilating, breathing because of the burn pain was so great. I had a nurse tell me, if you don't calm down, you're going to pass out. And I couldn't calm down. I was on fire, felt like I was on fire.
I went to the hospital that Kennedy and Livingston went to. And we were there for a few hours, I think. And then a doctor comes out and informs us that David Livingston had passed away. And that Kennedy was like hanging by a thread. You just keep replaying things in your head. And what if I did this? What if I did that? The ifs and buts, you know, and you just keep replaying it.
Dave Powell was a lot closer to David Livingston than most people knew. I remember looking over when I was at the funeral, and I remembered Powell just weeping. He feels responsible for the death of David. He really does. He felt responsible for the death of his friend.
As soon as I found out Livingston died, I wanted nothing more to do there for him. We were in the hospital 2 days before a single solitary Air Force personnel were out at the hospital.
They came in every 8 hours on my face, neck, and back, and they used a scrub pad. It was like a Brillo pad. They scrubbed all the skin, the dead skin, off so that the new skin would grow back. All the scrubbing was immensely painful. The Air Force was in a really big hurry to get me back to the base, so that no one could get to us, there could be no interviews, and you would not be speaking to the press.
The phone rang about 3:30 with a call from one of the airmen that said it just blew. The first thing I did was look around and say, I'm alive. We're alive. My family's alive. My neighborhood's alive. And my response was, where's the warhead? And the person said, we don't know.
When the Titan II missile exploded, I drove as fast as I could to the radio station and turned it back on the air.
The roadblocks will once again probably will be up throughout the remainder of the night and into the morning. That roadblock is on.
When you were trying to talk to the Air Force to find out, is there a nuclear warhead? Was one involved? Did you find it? Was it, but you know, what condition was it? Had it burst open? Was there uranium spread all over the area? They would not admit that there was even a nuclear warhead.
We could not tell the local populace or any of the political or law enforcement people that we had a warhead on a missile. That was, we could not confirm nor deny that we had a nuclear weapon on site. And that was a SAC and national policy at that time.
Was that warhead on there? You haven't even officially admitted that.
You know, I'm afraid that you and I are reaching an impasse on this question. I believe that I have answered the question as fully as I intend to.
Can you tell us where it is now?
May I have another question, please?
My personal feeling was it was a ridiculous policy, but nevertheless, we had to live with it.
Sheriff, has the Air Force told you very much?
They haven't told me a darn thing.
Does that make you mad?
Yes, it does. I need to know what's going on so I'll know how to handle the situation. And if they want to tell them in confidence, that'd be great. At least I know how to, you know, when and how to evacuate the people. Tell them, you know, not to return to their homes or to return to the home, how serious it is. But, of course, they don't, you know, they don't tell you that.
I heard the phrase, we will not confirm nor deny, probably 50 times in that week's period.
And once again, our word from the Air Force is, will not confirm nor deny.
One of the local merchants in town found the Air Force frequencies. So they wouldn't tell us anything. But we started getting this all relayed to us.
Could you give us a status on those EOD and disaster preparedness people? You're welcome to the hill.
They know that you're listening to them. So they're changing frequencies. And they said, be real evasive about what you talk about. They keep on talking about, we cannot find it, we cannot find the unit. And that's how we knew they were trying to figure out what happened to this nuclear warhead. Where did it go? We could tell there's some activity on the road going down to the silo, that they were showing a lot of interest right there in that one area.
I wish I had something secure. They've located what they want to locate, and it's laying in a ditch. Besides, you know, it's not even up close. It blew it out, and it's laying in the ditch, all exposed. And all I need to do is go and get it.
I went out there the next day. Somebody said, there it is. And it was in the ditch and somewhat, as I recall, somewhat buried. And then someone had called the nuclear people at Sandia to assess whether or not we had a hazardous situation.
The phone rang. They said, we got a problem. I knew I had to get to Damascus. We helicoptered into the silo. I was apprehensive. I knew that the warhead could have been armed, ready to fire. It was only after we had landed, I learned that because of the absence of any power source, the risk of a nuclear detonation was approximately zero.
Luckily, the explosion separated the warhead from its power source. That made a nuclear detonation impossible. But the luck could have gone another way.
Is there a warhead on the site? I cannot confirm or deny.
CNN, Channel 7, all the TV stations were on guard there. They were trying to get a shot of the warhead as it came out of the complex as they would leave.
Now, public information officers have promised us
They made a couple of dummy runs. They brought a couple of tractor-trailer trucks, and they would have escorts and lights, and they would come out of the compound real quick and hit the highway, then they would speed off out of there with something under a tarp on a trailer. Well, everybody would jump in their vehicles and head out. Well, about 15 minutes later, here would come another one doing the same thing.
I made a decision that we were going to move it at 5 o'clock the next morning, because they didn't want that warhead to be brought back during peak traffic times.
The flatbed truck carrying the two canisters was preceded and closely followed by military security police. One of the two canisters was believed to be carrying a 5-megaton thermonuclear warhead.
Officials do say the warhead will be taken apart at a plant near Amarillo, Texas. We don't know where it is right now. On the containers, there was the signature, "Do not drop."
The news reports all said there was no possibility that this warhead could have detonated. So it was a big news story for a few days, and then it was forgotten.
The governor of the state of Arkansas is Bill Clinton. As you can see, he's standing by in Little Rock this morning to talk with us about the situation. Do you think that the people of Arkansas who lived around the Titan II missile site, Governor, were in danger at the time of the explosion?
Well, Tom, of course, as regards the nuclear explosion, all we can do is to trust the experts there. They say there was never a danger of a nuclear explosion.
As far as the community itself is concerned and the danger from possible radioactive leak, if the warhead itself has been, if there is a warhead, and if it has been damaged, have you heard anything from Washington confirming whether there is one there or not?
I have not. I've heard rumors. I won't go into those right now.
I remember that Vice President Mondale, he was trying to find out, did this have a real warhead? This missile, was it armed with a nuclear warhead?
You know, when my vice commander, Colonel Ryan, went to the hot springs, Vice President Mondale asked that question, whether a nuclear weapon was involved. And of course, Colonel Ryan said, "I can't confirm or deny." And that's to the vice president. That's when he got on the phone with Secretary Brown.
The first thing I wanted to know was whether there had been any scattering of nuclear material, or still worse, a nuclear explosion. And when I heard that there had not been, my level of attention went way down. Accidents were not unusual in the Defense Department. There was at least, there must have been several every day. When public affairs people took over, the strategy was to let the Secretary of the Air Force handle it.
I spent many years working on the design of nuclear explosives, and I can guarantee you the one thing that we spend most time on is to make sure that they can't go off under any conceivable accidental circumstances, and that's as much as I want to say.
Was there a chance that that bomb could have detonated?
Yes.
We can't know. That's the thing that terrifies. We can't know what the risk is. I can't tell you it's going to detonate or not detonate, because every accident is this unpredictable set of circumstances.
There's a culture of secrecy around nuclear weapons that, on the one hand, has been necessary, on the other hand, has made the management of these weapons even more dangerous. According to the Department of Defense, there have been 32 broken arrows, that is, serious nuclear weapons accidents that could have endangered the public. But a few years ago, the Department of Energy released a declassified document that said there had been more than 1,000 accidents and incidents involving our nuclear weapons. Not only had the public not been told about these hundreds and hundreds of accidents, but even the man responsible for the safety of our nuclear weapons wasn't being told about accidents involving those weapons.
When I was the director of weapon development, I was unaware of a large number of accidents and incidents because I had no access to the information.
I was surprised when I read about the number of nuclear accidents that we had in the Air Force. I knew about some of those, but I didn't know there were so many.
Again and again, in looking at these documents, you find an effort to blame the person who dropped the wrench, who used the wrong tool in a Minuteman site, blew the warhead off the missile, who brought the seat cushions onto the plane that caught on fire and crashed the plane. There's this instinct to blame the operator, to blame the little guy. If the system worked properly, somebody dropping a tool couldn't send a nuclear warhead into a field.
No special precautions have been ordered at other Titan missile bases around the country because of that explosion in Arkansas.
In Arkansas, the system itself apparently did not fail. A mechanic's wrench fell from a ledge and struck the missile, puncturing a fuel tank. That is classified as human error.
The Air Force says the Titan is not to blame, that it was human error that caused the accident.
The accident that I've described here is unrelated to the state or the age of the system.
I was served with an Article 15 for dereliction of duty because I chose to use the ratchet instead of the torque wrench. Sergeant Kennedy got a letter of reprimand for violating the two-man rule.
I gave them my all. And what did I get from them? A letter of reprimand. A letter of reprimand for doing everything I thought was right.
After the accident, I thought that Kennedy and Devlin and the others that were hurt would be treated like heroes. Because they were. And they were treated like crap. They told Devlin that he couldn't do his job anymore, and they made him work at the coffee bar selling hot dogs and coffee. That was jobs that they gave to guys that were caught with drugs or getting DWIs or disobeying orders.
Some of the officials here at the airbase apparently have also changed their attitude towards some of the men who risked their lives that morning.
Channel 4 News called and said, "You want to tell us about how well the Air Force was treating you since the missile explosion?" I said, "Yeah, I'll tell them."
I worked 3.5 years, did a good job for 3.5 years, and then I wound up hurt from this explosion, and then all of a sudden they don't want you anymore. You know, you're not any good to them because you're crippled or injured for a while. So, no, I don't know, I don't know about the system. I don't know if I'm going to be railroaded out or, I don't know where I stand, really.
Oh, man, were they mad. I think every brass on base was mad at me. When I wore my military uniform with my boots on, I almost couldn't walk. I couldn't even move the boot because my ankle was shattered. There's no Achilles tendon. So I just went in and said, "Colonel, would it be possible for me to wear a gym shoe on my left foot?" He looked at me and he said, "Devlin, I wouldn't authorize a thing for you." I planned on staying in the Air Force for a career. Within only a few months, I knew I couldn't stay in the Air Force.
I kind of lost it. After that accident, I just had a meltdown. I went into the TV room where we all played cards and one evening, and there was beer bottles all over the place, and I just started throwing a bunch of beer bottles all over the place and took my frustrations out on that. The base commander, he gave me an honorable discharge, which I was thankful for, but that was not my goal, was to leave the military at that time.
There was an old motto that went around that to err was human, to forgive was in fact policy.
We have a checklist in our command post that calls for us to notify the OES. Now, I'm not saying it broke down there. Don't misconstrue what I'm saying. What I'm saying is from there on down, there was no plan. This is the test bed. 4-7 was the test bed, and nothing like this has ever happened before.
I tried to contact Colonel Mosher not too long after the accident, and I was told that he was no longer there. It almost appeared that he was gone in the night.
Even though, I just had 3 months there, I was in charge, and a senior guy is responsible for the whole operation. I expected I was going to lose my job. Let's put it that way. After that happened, I thought that would be the next step, and that happened on Thanksgiving. My regret was that I took orders from my boss. I clicked my heel like a good soldier and tried to execute those orders as best I could. And as a result of that, we lost life.
I think about Livingston often. What it'd be like to still have him around and call him up on the phone. And Jeff Kennedy passed away a couple of years ago. I have no doubt that Jeff died from being involved at Damascus. No doubt in my mind. I hear a song on the radio, I'll see something on TV, and bam, there it is, it's back, you know. It's very hard to talk about even today. I tried to live as normal a life as I can. But there isn't a day goes by that I don't think about it. 35 years, whatever it's been. Every day.
It went like clockwork, 6,500 pounds of explosives set to go at high noon. It marked the beginning of the end for the 17 missile silos in the state, perhaps a cruel fate for a facility that has served Arkansas and the country for 25 years.
If you didn't know they were there, you wouldn't know what it was now. It just looks like a small hill.
I think nowadays that people don't even think about all the nuclear weapons we have. They think that's all in the past and that they're not there anymore. And the reality is, they're all over the place.
If nothing goes wrong for 7 or 8 years, people don't think about it, don't realize it, unless you're working in that industry. People forget.
Nuclear accidents continue to the present day, although there have not been nearly as many occasions of things being dropped or blown out of silos. In part, that's because there are fewer of them. On the other hand, the degree of oversight and attention has, if anything, gotten worse because people don't worry about nuclear war as much.
Since the beginning of the atomic age, the United States has built about 70,000 nuclear weapons. None of them have ever detonated by accident. That's due to the skills of our weapons designers, whose safety recommendations were finally adopted, and the bravery of our military personnel. But it's also due to luck, pure luck. And the problem with luck is eventually it runs out. Nuclear weapons are machines. And every machine ever invented eventually goes wrong.
Doesn't matter how much you plan. Doesn't matter how many checklists you have. Somebody's got a ringer somewhere they're going to throw out there at you.
Nuclear weapons will always have a chance of an accidental
detonation. It will happen. It may be tomorrow, or it may be a million years from now, but it will happen.
American Experience.
Children born today are exposed to these chemicals from birth. What is going to happen to them as a result of that exposure?
She helped launch the modern environmental movement.
She was determined that this message would get out. She's willing to endure almost everything to get that message out.
Rachel Carson, coming to American Experience. American Experience, Command and Control, is available on DVD. To order, visit shoppbs.org or call 1-800-PLAY-PBS. American Experience is also available for download on iTunes.
Is it BMAT?
BMAT ready.
MFT?
Deputy?
Deputy ready. Crew is ready. Ready?
You had to be prepared to destroy an entire civilization. And we were trained on that. I still today refer to myself and other missileers as crew dogs. You had to almost be rote in your actions and not question the fact that you were going to destroy an entire civilization if you had to launch those ICBMs. As heartless as it sounds, I never had a problem with it. I was doing it for my country. I was doing it to protect my country. The whole reason I sat out there was to prevent that kind of thing from happening. That's what deterrence was about. But deterrence is worthless if you don't demonstrate that you're willing to do it, too. And we always had to demonstrate that I would walk out there and turn those keys in a second, and I would kill 10 million people and never hesitate. Every time I went onto a complex,
went down three flights of stairs. At the bottom of that, you got to a blast door. There were a series of blast doors, 6, 7, 8, and 9.
So you'd walk through this and you'd step into the middle level of the Launch Control Center with all of the equipment that you needed to maintain the missile.
When we took charge of a complex, that meant that we owned that missile until the next crew came out. So if we went to war, we were prepared to launch those weapons on command.
Apps power, silo soft, guidance go, we're standing by for fire engine.
We never knew what our specific targets were because you didn't really want to know who you were going to destroy.
Turning on my command of ready to turn keys, on the word keys we will turn. Is the crew ready? The BMAT?
Ready.
MFT?
Ready.
Deputy?
Deputy ready.
Crew is ready. Ready?
You had to be prepared to destroy an entire civilization.
Complex 3-1 has Phase 14 missile age inspection.
That day, September 18th, it was basically 5 days before my 24th birthday. So I was 23. Lieutenant Childers was 24 as the deputy.
When we went on alert in a Titan system, we were on alert for 24 hours. That's what a tour was, 24 hours. We had 18 silos spread all the way out to the eastern corner of Arkansas. We went to a complex where there was supposed to be very little maintenance. That was 4-7.
We went up the main highway to a certain point, and then you had to pull off the highway onto much smaller roads. Until you came over a particular rise.
Others, who's 24, is the deputy.
When we went on alert in a Titan system,
We were on alert for 24 hours. That's what a tour was, 24 hours. We had 18 silos spread all the way out to the eastern corner of Arkansas. We went to a complex where there was supposed to be very little maintenance. That was 4-7.
We went up the main highway to a certain point, and then you had to pull off the highway onto much smaller roads. Until you came over a particular rise, you wouldn't even know that the missile complex was there.
As we drove up to Missile Complex 4-7, it's very unassuming. There's not a lot there. There's this huge door, and there's some antennas. However, underneath that door was the most powerful warhead.
He had a hole in his leg the size of your fist. He was really hurt bad. And he told me to go find Livingston. We put our helmets on and we went onto the site. It was like another world. Ordnance guys had told us that the warhead was full of plastic explosives that could be laying all over the ground. So somehow we were not supposed to step on them. There was giant chunks of concrete blasted all over. It looked like the size of semi-trucks. There's a strange glow coming out of where the silo used to be. And when we got back to the truck, they had already found Livingston. Said the warhead was full of plastic explosives that could be laying all over the ground. So somehow we were not supposed to step on them. There was giant chunks of concrete blasted all over. It looked like the size of semi-trucks. There's a strange glow coming out of where the silo used to be. And when we got back to the truck, they had already found Livingston. And I was angry because they didn't have an ambulance. Put him in the back of a pickup truck. And I held him. He begged me not to tell his mother.
Gus was sitting in his sheriff's car. I was sitting on the hood of Gus's car, just kind of sitting there, and had on slip-on shoes and was kicking one off and on. Then all of a sudden, it was just cold. Everybody was running as hard as they could to get out of there because we may be living our last few minutes. I thought when I jumped in my car and drove as hard as I could that I was probably outrunning a nuclear blast. You know, I thought this Dodge Omni is going to outrun this thing, you know. And I remember we had almost made it to Choctaw, and I turned to Tom and I said, "We just left a bunch of dead people back there, Tom."
The sky just lit up. It really looked like the sun was coming up. Which is why our initial reaction was.
I think David was just scared to say anything about really what was happening. Only being 21 years old, I guess it'd almost be like, you know, you're doing something wrong as a kid and you gotta tell your parents about it, you know? You know how you're gonna just stand there and you don't wanna say what you just did?
I grabbed Plum and we walked back up the cableway. I immediately started looking at the fuel level reader. When it hits that explosive level, any spark can set off the fuel.
You could run through each of the tanks on each stage and see what the pressure was. And we saw that the pressure was dropping. It was dropping fast.
From being involved at Damascus, no doubt in my mind. I hear a song on a radio, I'll see something on TV, and bam, there it is, it's back, you know. It's very hard to talk about even today. I tried to live as normal a life as I can. But there isn't a day goes by that I don't think about it. 35 years, whatever it's been. Every day. Ready to begin the checklist for pressurization of stage two oxidizer tank.
We had a problem with that ratchet. It wouldn't allow Dave to actually get the socket to clip or snap into place to be secure. He held the socket up against the dust cap and he put the ratchet up against it.
Basically, you hold it with one hand on that ratchet handle and one hand cradles the head of the ratchet with the socket on it.
And so I got on the end of it and kind of gave it a little force. And I remember saying to him, you got this? Yeah, I got it. Let go of it.
And I go to pick it up and the socket falls off the end of the ratchet.
Just boom, right through the hole and just straight down. As it was falling.
September 18th was one of those days where nothing was going the way it was supposed to go.
Step one, power on-off switch, on.
What we did every day is we went through a daily shift verification checklist. We had a whole book full of checklists and we lived by checklists.
On-off rotary switch, on.
That day, September 18th, we find out that we're going to actually have some major maintenance because they have a problem with the oxidizer tank that pressure is a little bit low.
Each stage of the missile had two separate tanks. One was filled with fuel and the other was filled with oxidizer.
All you got to do is mix those two fuels and you're going to have an explosion. We called back to base. They said we had a maintenance team coming out, a specialized unit. They called them the PTS team.
I gave them my all. And what did I get from them? A letter of reprimand. A letter of reprimand for doing everything I thought was right.
After the accident, I thought that Kennedy and Devlin and the others that were hurt would be treated like heroes. Because they were. And they were treated like crap. They told Devlin that he couldn't do his job anymore and they made him work at the coffee bar selling hot dogs and coffee. That was jobs that they gave to guys that were caught with drugs or getting DWIs or disobeying orders.
Some of the officials here at the airbase apparently have also changed their attitude towards some of the men who risked their lives that morning.
Channel 4 News called and said, you want to tell us about hours, I think. And then a doctor comes out and informs us that David Livingston had passed away. And that Kennedy was like hanging by a thread. You just keep replaying things in your head. What if I did this? What if I did that? The ifs and buts, you know, and you just keep replaying it.
Dave Powell was a lot closer to David Livingston than most people knew. I remember looking over when I was at the funeral, and I remembered Powell just weeping. He feels responsible for the death of David. He really does. He felt responsible for the death of his friend.
As soon as I found out Livingston died, I wanted nothing more to do there for him. We were in the hospital 2 days before a single solitary Air Force personnel were out at that hospital.
They came in every
activity on the road, going down to the silo. That they were showing a lot of interest right there in that one area.
I wish I had something secure. They located what they want to locate, and it's laying in a ditch. Besides, you know, it's not even up close. It blew it out, and it's laying in the ditch, all exposed. And all I need to do is go and get it.
I went out there the next day. Somebody said, there it is. And it was in the ditch and somewhat, as I recall, somewhat buried. And then someone had called the nuclear people at Sandia to assess whether or not we had a hazardous situation.
The phone rang. They said, we got a problem. I knew I had to get to Damascus. We helicoptered into the silo.
As all the bombs used by all of the armies in the Second World War, including both the atomic bombs. When the crew members successfully turned the keys, that 330,000-pound missile would lift up out of the silo.
And it would head out for about 5 minutes of powered flight to the edge of space, fly for another 20 minutes, and hit its target halfway around the world.
Before September 18th, the only warheads that we thought would go off in the United States would be Soviet warheads. We never considered that our own warheads could detonate on our own continent.
And be the best PTS chief, team chief ever.
When I arrived at Little Rock Air Force Base, I would have been 19. Yeah. Oh, no, 18. My birthday is in March, so I would have been 1 month away from being 19. I think I was ready to take on the world at that point. I wanted to go out to the field and work on that Titan II missile. You know, we called it a bird, and I wanted to work on the birds, you know.
Rocket fuel is extremely poisonous. We were always told if we could smell it, it was already too much.
Oxidizer, when you breathe it, it turns to nitric acid. And you basically drown in your lungs if you breathe enough of it.
We would work 12, 14 hour, up to 16 hour shifts. And then go to sleep, and then 5 hours later or so, you get up and head back.
At that time, and not that we didn't care about our lives, but, you know, it just seemed that it made sense to us that we should stay and let everybody else go.
On the evening of September 18th, people were gathering in Hot Springs. Vice President Mondale was the keynote speaker. Senator Pryor and Governor Clinton and others had already gone to Hot Springs. And I was scheduled to go over the next day. That night, we had invited a friend over for dinner, and the phone rang. And it was one of the airmen whom I had talked with. But when I got off the phone from this airman, I looked around.
was fairly new to working out on the missile sites. At the age of 19, you know, you've got that no fear mentality. Right above us was a 9-megaton thermonuclear warhead. To see the magnitude of that weapon within 10 feet from you, it was a monster waiting to go off. When you think about working on a weapon of mass destruction, you're counting on everything to work perfect all the time. And things just don't work perfect all the time.
We knew that fire, for example, could set off these electro-explosive devices inside the warhead in a random way.
During a fire, the solder might melt on a circuit board. It created all kinds of new electrical pathways that could completely circumvent a safety device.
Of the 20 or 25,000 weapons that we had in stockpile, I could not, in good conscience, swear that they were adequately safe.
You had Bob Purifoy, one of the vice presidents of the lab, and Bill Stevens, the head of the safety department at Sandia, saying thousands of weapons in the American nuclear arsenal were vulnerable during an accident, including the most powerful warhead on an American missile, the warhead on top of the Titan II.
And I was picking people up and carrying them up the road, trying to get them away from the debris. I remember helping one of them into the back of a truck. And as we were carrying him, the suit would snag on rocks and rebar and just wrench his broken leg, and he was just screaming in pain.
And they said, "Devlin, you got to go to the hospital." And I said, "No, don't take me until you have Livingston, until you have Kennedy. I don't want to leave until you have everybody." And he said, "No, man, we got it. We're going to send you now. We got to get you to the hospital."
All you heard was, "Evacuate, evacuate, evacuate." Air Force Colonel said, "The other two are on the site. They have to be dead." And we looked down at the site and said, "I'm with you, Colonel. They have to be dead." I got into the last truck that was there with a bunch of hurt guys. And I said, "Let's go."
And it was therefore available for an accident.
Of the 18 Titan missiles stationed in Kansas, there were serious leaks in 17. Nearly 14,000 gallons of poisonous liquid fuel poured out, killing two persons and injuring more than 20 others.
The Titan II's potentially an awesome weapon of war, whose only victims so far have been Americans.
There are stories about accidents that might have happened in Kansas or maybe one or two smaller ones in Arkansas. I think more and more it became a matter of concern.
A year before the Damascus accident, Senator David Pryor and I toured a Titan missile site. We were concerned about safety issues. They were very helpful. They answered questions. And we had a very pleasant educational tour of a Titan missile site. We talked about how helpful it was. And quite frankly, had some reassurance that maybe things were okay, that maybe things weren't as bad as we had been led.
Pry open the main lock and then go down three levels of steps to get to your first 6,000 pound blast lock door with great big hydraulic pins that lock it in place. We had to manually start to pump it open. We'd never used that hydraulic pump. We were getting close to the 30 minutes of air, and then they sent us back. So they said, "You guys got it hooked up, come on back. We're gonna send Kennedy and Livingston in to replace you."
Those guys were brave. They knew what they were getting into when they went back in on the underground, what could happen to them.
I was sitting in a security police vehicle listening and hearing what's going on. The next team went in, which was going to be Kennedy and Livingston. They're relaying the information that they've opened the blast door.
And then there was a realization that the weapons were nowhere near as safe as everyone had assumed.
We knew that fire, for example, could set off these electro-explosive devices inside the warhead in a random way.
During a fire, the solder might melt on a circuit board. It created all kinds of new electrical pathways that could completely circumvent a safety device.
Of the 20 or 25,000 weapons that we had in stockpile, I could not, in good conscience, swear that they were adequately safe.
You had Bob Purifoy, one of the vice presidents of the lab, and Bill Stevens, the head of the safety department at Sandia, saying thousands of weapons in the American nuclear arsenal were vulnerable during an accident.
They were telling me that it wasn't a matter of if we were going to have an explosion, it was a matter of when. After that meeting, we proposed a warning siren at each of the silos, much like a tornado warning sign.
On Tuesday, I passed an amendment going to mandate the Air Force to put early warning systems on all of the 54 missile sites in this country.
The passage of that amendment was on September 17th, 2 days before the tragedy at Damascus.
September 18th, 1980, I got a call from the command post that we had a serious problem.
Bruce Brennan. Bruce Brennan.
And he told us to evacuate and not go down there. And I said, screw you, our friends are down there, we're going. I got back to the missile site. I saw Kennedy. He was burnt. And he had a hole in his leg the size of your fist. He was really hurt bad. And he told me to go find Livingston. We put our helmets on and we went onto the site. It was like another world. Ordnance guys had told us that the warhead was full of plastic explosives that could be laying all over the ground. So somehow we were nuts.
On the other hand, has made the management of these weapons even more dangerous. According to the Department of Defense, there have been 32 broken arrows. That is, serious nuclear weapons accidents that could have endangered the public. But a few years ago, the Department of Energy released a declassified document that said there'd been more than 1,000 accidents and incidents involving our nuclear weapons. Not only had the public not been told about these hundreds and hundreds of accidents, but even the man responsible for the safety of our nuclear weapons wasn't being told about accidents involving those weapons.
When I was the director of weapon development, I was unaware of a large number of accidents and incidents because I had no access to the information.
I was surprised when I read about the number of nuclear
in the front yard, people walking out to their cars, carrying on their normal everyday lives. And I thought, do I run out on the street and say, we got a potential nuclear explosion 46 miles from here? Do I grab my friends and neighbors and get in the car and start driving? Do I call Senator Pryor and say, let's call a press conference and tell him that the Air Force is not telling the truth? What do you do?
I was there in the Hot Springs at night, and the phone rang, and it was Skip. And Skip says, we have a problem.
He said, what's the Air Force saying? I said, the Air Force is telling people it's not happening. That's what they've told the people on the site. They're going to tell you that these things are under control. But I think you need to be prepared for an explosion.
And Devlin and the others that were hurt would be treated like heroes, because they were. And they were treated like crap. They told Devlin that he couldn't do his job anymore, and they made him work at the coffee bar selling hot dogs and coffee. That was jobs that they gave to guys that were caught with drugs or getting DWIs or disobeying orders.
Some of the officials here at the airbase apparently have also changed their attitude towards some of the men who risked their lives that morning.
Channel 4 News called and said, you want to tell us about how well the Air Force is treating you since the missile explosion? I said, yeah, I'll tell them.
I worked 3.5 years, did a good job for 3.5 years, and then I wound up hurt from this explosion, and then all of a sudden they don't want you anymore. You know, you're not any good to them because you're crippled or injured for a while. So, no, I don't know, you know, I don't know if, you know, I don't know about the system.
After that, within seconds, I saw the explosion.
PTS-1, do you copy?
All of a sudden, I lost all communications.
PTS-1, do you copy? I repeat, PTS-1, do you copy?
Everything you ever read or heard about a nuclear explosion, all communications were lost until things settled out. And that's the first thing that's the first thing that entered my mind, that we had a nuclear explosion out there. And we may have a shockwave coming into Little Rock Air Force Base and all the surrounding communities. And that's the first thing I thought about. And all the people would be dead out there on site, of course. And I just, it was unimaginable.
I think David was just scared to say anything about really what was happening. Only being 21 years old, I guess it'd almost be like, you know, you're doing something wrong as a kid and you gotta tell your parents about it, you know? You know how you're gonna just stand there and you don't wanna say what you just did?
I grabbed Plum and we walked back up the cableway. I immediately started looking at the fuel level reader. When it hits that explosive level, any spark can set off the fuel.
You could run through each of the tanks on each stage and see what the pressure was. And we saw that the pressure was dropping. It was dropping fast. And then all of a sudden, sprays came on in a launch duct. We thought, well, there must be a fire. It doesn't make any sense. Nothing made any sense. And I jumped into my checklist. We did everything according to checklist. You know, we ran the oxidizer checklist. We ran the fuel checklist. You know, you stay in the checklist, it'll take care of you.
About that time, the PTS team that had been out working had gotten back. And they're standing over in the short cableway, and the maintenance team chief went over and met them, and they started talking. At that point, I said, okay, guys, what happened? And they came in, and then they explained to the crew at that point exactly what happened.
And that's when we finally got him to admit that he had done something, that he had dropped it, and there was a hole. And he saw vapors coming out. It was more than uh-oh. And that was the first time we knew it was good half hour into it. By then, it was basically out of control.
When I became Secretary of Defense, we had tens of thousands of nuclear weapons. The numbers were a big problem because it only takes a few or one getting out of hand to cause a catastrophic problem. And we worried about that. We probably didn't worry about it enough. The Titan II missiles by 1980 were both old and much more prone to accidents.
At a silo near Searcy, 53 construction workers died when a welding torch sparked flammable hydraulic oil.
Nitrogen tetroxide drifted from the missile site.
This would be missile leak number 10 so far in Arkansas.
Why was it still in the arsenal? In part because it was the only missile that had a heavy payload.
The United States had 1,000 land-based missiles, and those 54 Titan IIs represented one-third of the megatonnage of our entire missile force. In September 1980, the Soviet Union was in the midst of a huge nuclear arms buildup. By then, they had more land-based missiles than we did.
It also, I think, was part of a negotiating strategy. We anticipated trading them off against Soviet heavy missiles in strategic arms negotiations.
It was a bargaining chip, something that we could give up in order to persuade the Soviets to get rid of a class of their missiles.
So that was why we still had it, and it was therefore available for an accident.
Of the 18 Titan missiles stationed in Kansas, there were serious leaks in 17.
Nearly 14,000 gallons of poisonous liquid fuel poured out, killing two persons and injuring more than 20 others.
The Titan II's potentially an awesome weapon of war, whose only victims so far have been Americans.
There are stories about accidents that might have happened in Kansas or maybe one or two smaller ones in Arkansas. I think more and more it became a matter of concern.
A year before the Damascus accident, Senator David Pryor and I toured a Titan missile site. We were concerned about safety issues. They were very helpful. They answered questions. And we had a very pleasant educational tour of a Titan missile site. We talked about how helpful it was. And quite frankly, had some reassurance that maybe things were okay, that maybe things weren't as bad as we had been led to believe.
I was very, very impressed with it. Was, of course, the Titan II. It's about 110 feet tall.
We get back, and in a matter of no time, a phone call comes from some airmen who said they'd like to meet with us. They wanted to come to our office. They didn't want anybody to know that we were meeting.
We met there that night. Scared to death. You know, we were 20-something kids. We had no idea what we were doing.
We took the logbook to their office and showed them. They put your life in danger, and they didn't tell you that when they sent you out there.
The day that they had walked the senator through the site, their hazard sensing system was off alert. If the system is down, you could have vapors from the silo that could kill you. And so they should have provided the senator with a gas mask. But they just walked him through like it was a normal day and there was no problem. The Air Force didn't want the senator to have any understanding of just how unreliable the systems were. People inside of our chain of command weren't listening to us, and that's why we went to Senator Pryor. And we told him about our absolute fear for the safety of Arkansas, the safety of everybody working on those systems.
They were telling me that It wasn't a matter of if we were going to have an explosion. It was a matter of when. After that meeting, we proposed a warning siren at each of the silos, much like a tornado warning sign.
On Tuesday, I passed an amendment going to mandate the Air Force to put early warning systems on all of the 54 missile sites in this country.
The passage of that amendment was on September 17th, 2 days before the tragedy at Damascus.
September 18th, 1980, I got a call from the command post that we had a serious problem. In June of 1980, I had assumed command of the 308th Strategic Missile Wing at Little Rock Air Force Base, and that was a Titan wing. I had no previous experience in Titan. I had no training in Titan, so I was a new guy. I had about 3 months under my belt before the accident occurred on the night of September 18th. I got to the command center, started to figure out what was going on. Nobody knew too much about what happened except that a socket dropped in a silo. I had heard before that tools have been dropped, but they always went straight to the bottom. But in this case, it penetrated the missile. I had no idea that that could ever happen. I had never even given that a thought at all. And then I activated the Missile Potential Hazard Team.
The Missile Potential Hazard Team gathered together some of the top figures in the Air Force to deal with the accident. At Barksdale Air Force Base in Louisiana, there was Colonel Ben Scaller, the Air Force's leading expert on the Titan II missile.
As we're dumping fuel, things are heating up in that silo in the launch deck all the time. If the temperature rises, the oxidizer expands, and there's a possibility that it can rupture a tank. And with a silo full of fuel, you rupture an oxidizer tank, and the oxidizer hits the fuel, it's gone.
In Denver, there were executives from Martin Marietta who designed and built the Titan II missile.
And in Omaha, Nebraska, there was the underground headquarters of the Strategic Air Command, known as SAC. That night, all the major decisions would be made at SAC headquarters.
The Strategic Air Command handled the nuclear weapons for the Air Force. SAC was a very, very professional organization, and there were no errors really tolerated.
The night of the accident, General Lloyd Levitt assumed control of the Missile Potential Hazard Team.
General Levitt was a very dedicated pilot, a very courageous pilot in Korea and Vietnam, but he had no missile background at all that I'm aware of. As things progressed, we were trying to do everything we could. We knew what was going to happen if we lost pressure in a fuel tank. Of course, the missile was going to collapse on top of itself. The pressures in the tanks kept the missile erect. If we lost all the pressure in that, the missile would collapse upon itself. If the missile collapsed, the entire missile would blow up. But what would happen to the warhead was anybody's guess. There was no one that we kept on alert that knew anything about the warhead. There was no checklist. Probably the only thing that I ever was involved with was Strategic Air Command that there wasn't a checklist for. And so it became a seat of the pants operation as things unfolded. And I used every resource we had that night to try to face the problem and solve the problem. One of the options was, if the silo closure door was open, there's a possibility that the gas could have been vented. But there was also a possibility, if the missile did explode while that door was open, we throw the warhead out of the silo. We would not have known where it went. It could go almost anywhere.
Very few people, almost none in a decision-making capacity, have ever seen a nuclear explosion. I went out to the Pacific in 1954. I would have been 26, having worked for a couple of years before then on the development of nuclear weapons.
In 1954, the United States was testing a new design for a hydrogen bomb. It was the same sort of weapon that would later be put on top of the Titan II. It had been anticipated that the blast would be about 5 megatons. That is the equivalent of 5 million tons of TNT. When the device detonated, there was an enormous explosion that got bigger and bigger and bigger. And soon, the observers were terrified because they didn't know when it was going to stop. The Bravo test wound up being 3 times more powerful than they had estimated.
I saw it go off from a distance of 200 miles. All you see is the light. The light stays on for a long time. And if you see it from total darkness, it gets bright enough to read a newspaper by that light. That's enormously impressive. Everybody knew that there was a great deal of radioactivity generated in a nuclear explosion. The question always was, what would happen to it?
Radiation survey teams were flown back to the exposed atoll.
We were able to document for the first time fallout data from high-yield detonations. Fallout blanketed areas of more than 5,000 square miles with radioactive material that would have been lethal to unprotected personnel.
Back in Washington, they took a map of the fallout pattern from the Bravo test and they superimposed it on a map of the United States. A similar weapon detonated over Washington, D.C. could release enough radioactive fallout to kill everyone in Washington, D.C., everyone in Baltimore, everyone in Philadelphia, half the population of New York City, with casualties and fatalities as far north as Boston.
The fuel tank reading started going negative. And at that point, I felt that it was potentially going to collapse. And although there are safety measures within the warhead, in the back of my mind, you always wonder. I don't think anybody truly knew what was going to happen with the warhead.
As they were talking about these tank pressures and all these different things, I'm getting more and more anxious and more and more anxious, thinking, we need to get out of here. We need to get the hell out of this complex because this thing's going to blow up.
At this point, Mazzara wanted to evacuate the control center. He didn't really want to be down there if it did explode.
Some of the crew members were eager to make an exit. So with that in mind, we started discussing, should we evacuate the people in the launch control center or leave them in there? the reason to get him out of the silo. We had no idea what was going to happen to the launch control center if the missile exploded.
I still thought we should be there. We needed to be there.
If we evacuated that launch control center, we would be giving up any ability to control any of the equipment. We would be giving up the capacity to try any of the ideas that people were trying to come up with in order to save this system.
Rodney and I told the crew commander that we wanted to stay behind. I couldn't leave. You know, emotionally, I couldn't go.
From our standpoint, we could stay because neither one of us had children at that time. And not that we didn't care about our lives, but, you know, it just seemed that it made sense to us that we should stay and let everybody else go.
On the evening of September 18th, people were gathering in Hot Springs. Vice President Mondale was the keynote speaker. Senator Pryor and Governor Clinton and others had already gone to Hot Springs. And I was scheduled to go over the next day. That night, we had invited a friend over for dinner, and the phone rang. And it was one of the airmen whom I had talked with. But when I got off the phone from this airman, I looked around and people started asking me, saying, what's happening? And I said, a Titan missile is going to explode. And the question was, well, what does that mean? What it means is if that nuclear warhead explodes, we're incinerated. I said, Little Rock's gone. I said, Little Rock is gone. We're 46 miles from this site. We're gone. I walked into our living room and looked out the front window. And it was still daylight savings time. So it wasn't totally dark, and you could see children in the front yard, people walking out to their cars, carrying on their normal everyday lives. And I thought, do I run out on the street and say, we got a potential nuclear explosion 46 miles from here? Do I grab my friends and neighbors and get in the car and start driving? Do I call Senator Pryor and say, let's call a press conference and tell them that the Air Force is not telling the truth? What do you do?
I was there in the Hot Springs at night, and the phone rang, and it was Skip. And Skip says, we have a problem.
He said, what's the Air Force saying? I said, the Air Force is telling people it's not happening. That's what they've told the people on the site. They're going to tell you that these things are under control. But I think you need to be prepared for an explosion.
As the general manager of the radio station in Clinton, we were doing quite a bit of local news. And you realize in a small town that you need to have a police scanner because everything comes off of it. And the person said, we've got a chemical leak at the Titan II missile silo. We get there about the same time the sheriff is getting there, Gus Anglin. This is Gus Anglin. He was the sheriff of Van Buren County. Very popular sheriff, by the way. And so we decided to walk down the narrow road that goes down to the silo. And when you get down there, there's like this 10-foot tall chain link fencing with barbed wire on the top of it. Out of nowhere, here comes two guys with M16 rifles. Gus says, do I need to start evacuating? Oh, no, sir. We've got it under control, I assure you. You know, if they'd come up and said, man, we got a hell of a situation, this thing may blow like hell, I'd have got out of there.
You know, the attitude that a lot of military commanders have was to tell everybody, everything's okay, we'll take care of it. And that's what we were doing that night. That was the wrong answer.
So we went back to the edge of the road, which is just off Highway 65. There's homes real close to the silo.
My mother said, there's something wrong at the missile base. There's cars, there's a lot of cars going in. The missile site is probably less than a quarter of a mile through the field from the back door. They basically condemned our land and took it. We didn't know the danger. We didn't know that that was a nuclear missile there.
I mean, it was a secret base. It had a chain link fence with barbed wire around the top, guards. Big signs on the fence said, we're gonna shoot you if you come in here. But you wasn't gonna change it, and we wasn't gonna move. It just didn't make much sense to dwell on it, so you just put up with it. You know, like bad neighbor or in-law or something, you know? But the crowds are starting to gather on 65.
This is as close as the military will allow us to get.
So here comes Channel 4, here comes Channel 11. Before you know it, we've got about 25 people out there. They ignored us. We'd yell at them as they'd come by. You go, hey, is everything under control? You know, have you fixed it yet? And they'd just keep driving. They wouldn't even acknowledge that you existed.
My dad talked to a man that was in law enforcement that he knew. This law enforcement man said, Ralph, get your family and get out of here. And if you tell this, I'll get fired. And we all got together and drove to Choctaw to spend the night.
Sheriff Gus Angler, he didn't get the information he felt he needed from them to make really good decisions. And finally, he just went to running everybody off when they were evacuating. He said, I don't know how bad it's going to be or anything else. Get out of here right now, and then we'll get you back in quick as we can. They had roadblocks set up like 2 miles from it, diverting traffic around the area. I had a problem that 9 months before that happened, I had synchronized a bunch of heifers, which means you give them a shot of luteolite, they all come in heat at the same time. You breed them all at the same time, which also means they're all going to calve at the same time. Well, they were due date was that day. We would have lost the farm, everything we had, you know, if them cows got sick and died. So I mean, we were going back in.
We finally made the decision to evacuate the crew because when a missile explodes, if it does explode, you're risking life of the 4 crew members on site. So we thought the best avenue was to take the crew out of the control center.
Mike said, we're gonna have to evacuate. It was one of the hardest things I think anybody could do because you were responsible for a nuclear weapon that was capable of destroying an unbelievable amount of territory and an unbelievable number of people. And you were leaving it behind. And you owned it, you know, for that alert, you owned it and you had to give it up. And there was nobody to give it to. Nobody left it before. Nobody would leave a nuclear warhead. The whole time I was leaving, I kept thinking, I need to stay, I should have stayed. I look back on it now, I still can't believe we left it empty. I had all these classified checklists. Nobody had ever tried to put them in a safe before. They wouldn't fit. So we left all of them in the safe with the door open.
Fuel vapor can ignite, and so we need to cut as much electrical power from the silo as we can. We don't want any electrical spark or anything going on.
We thought, we're gonna go out the regular way. We'll open the door up.
As we started to open the blast door, we immediately saw vapor. Once we closed that door, that cut off our main escape route. We were instructed to evacuate through the emergency escape hatch, which we had never actually fully opened.
It's just a metal tube with a ladder in it.
buried a good 40 feet under the ground.
There's a light at the top, and it's supposed to shine down into the escape route. And it didn't come on. It wasn't working. Nothing was working.
We had donned gas masks because there was some concern about missile fuel vapors blowing over the escape hatch.
It was a hell of a thing to climb up five stories in the dark with this mask on, and you couldn't breathe, and it filled up with vapors, and you couldn't see anything.
We knew there was very little wind that night, and all of the vapors that were being evacuated out of the launch duct was settling over the site.
I was at home with my wife and kid, and I got a call from job control. And they said they had a problem out at 4-7. So I drove up to the barracks, and I was banging on doors getting PTS guys.
They told everybody here, this is a very dangerous situation. We don't know what's going to happen. This is a purely voluntary mission only. And if you don't want to go, you don't have to go. The PTS group, there's like a brotherhood. There's no question that we weren't going to be the team that was going out there. Dave Livingston was one of the guys, and he was sitting in the back seat. And he said to me, somebody's going to die out here tonight. I just feel it. And I said, Dave, don't say something like that, man. Don't even say it. And he goes, no, I got a bad vibe, man. Somebody's going to die out here, man.
We know at this point that there's a helicopter on the way, and Jeff Kennedy was on there. He was one of the best, if not the best, team chief in the wing.
Jeff Kennedy was the kind of guy that he would never ask you to do anything he wouldn't do himself.
He had an authoritative voice that would just, you know, kind of rattle your cage.
When I got on site, Powell come running up to me and said, Jeff, I got like you wouldn't believe. I know that I need to get the tank ready.